She had found out in the postdoctoral research after that, and so on. So I didn't know about this till I had actually found it. But I remember when she left us, passed away in 2006, November 17. Just 3 or 4 months before that, I got my... what you do is that when you do research, you get a PhD, okay? But then universities honor you with honorary doctorates. Like I've got doctorate from
DP.
This university itself. So I had got my 25th honorary doctorate. And I remember my telling her that I've got my 25th doctorate. And she said, now I'm happy. And she left us within 3 months. Okay? By the way, next month I'm getting my 40th honorary doctorate.
Yes, 39 you are already.
I know she'll be watching from somewhere and she'll be. It is exactly the same thing with my wife by profession. Because what happens if I'm doing 24/7, working for the society, working for the nation, somebody has to take care of the children. Somebody has to be very tolerant. When you come home, you cannot. You get the so kind of support she has given is absolutely fantastic because my schedules are absolutely crazy. So without these two women, we could not. So actually, it is the mother, the wife, the sister, their roles, and in society, professionally, how are you unequal? You are not only equal in many areas. You are better. In fact, I remember when I was the director of National Chemical Laboratory, we had a division of biochemistry. As a joke, people used to call it division of biochemistry. Because 90% of them were girls. And they were so superb, as a matter of fact. You know, Nobel Prizes have been won. Can you name one of the lady Nobel Prize winner?
Madam.
Yes, and as a scientist, who has won it?
Madame
Curie.
Yes.
Have you heard it?
Mm-hmm.
So, you can do that. That's the issue. Good. Very good. So, excellent question and very right. I think that is what we should be pushing in India. I will send you my lecture. Please read it. Good. Thank you. Yeah. Yes, come.
Good morning, sir. My name is Jane Anji. I'm currently in 9th grade. Sir, I would like to know more about Gandhian engineering. And are there any right now examples for it?
Okay, but you didn't tell me what is your idea of New India.
I
will tell you about Gandhian engineering. But you tell me about your idea of New India.
My idea for India. Everyone should have right to education. Education is the people who are poor, they don't have access to education. So I would like to work for that and give them education.
Excellent. I always say the most powerful equation is E equal to F. Education is equal to future. Isn't it? I wouldn't be here or you wouldn't be coming to me if that equation was not valid. And education does wonderful things. You know, unequals become equal. It is very interesting. I gave this R.K. Narayanan Memorial Oration. You know who R.K. Narayanan was? Our past president. Right? So in his name there is a lecture. I gave it in Canberra on 19th of April. And there I have talked about this equation. Education is equal to future. And to prove it, I cite 13 March 2000, what happened on that day. We were all in Rashtrapati Bhavan. And R.K. Narayanan and I have a similar story of life. Just, I was born in poverty and I struggled to get education. He was also born in an extremely poor family. He used to walk 5 to 6 kilometers to go to the school and go back. and his parents were so poor they couldn't afford tuition fees. All right. So what he would do is that he would be standing outside the class and listening, because the teacher, I mean the parents could not. And then he also got Tata scholarship like me. All right. And he went on to become president of India. And then on that day I got Padma Bhushan. And you know, on the same day, Ratan Tata also got Padma Bhushan. Now you can just imagine R.K. Narayanan, a Tata scholar, becoming a president and giving Padma Bhushan on one hand to Tata, with the head of the Tata family, because of whom he could become president, and on the other hand giving it to another Tata scholar, to me. This is the magic of education. It makes people equal. It doesn't matter where you basically come from. So I think you're hit the nail. Okay. Now, as far as Gandhian engineering is concerned, I will talk about it a little later. But because I'm trying to learn from you, what goes on in your head. You understand, I'm trying to learn first before I teach you or say something. Yeah. So, wonderful question again.
Good morning, sir. Myself, Pratham Barrett of class 10. Sir, India should be all-rounder in every aspect of life, and in politics, and the discrimination on basis of caste, religion, race should be totally vanished, and we must develop the country from the bottommost position of the country.
Excellent. So you are bothered by the fact that we are divided because of caste, religion, language, and so on, isn't it? I'm very happy to hear that concern. So let me tell you about an experiment that changed my life, and then link it to what you are saying. Because we want a united India, or United States of India, not divided state of India. And from your question, I find that you are bothered by the fact that we are getting divided, isn't it? On the basis of caste, religion, language, etc. So how do we unite ourselves? I'm mentioning this also because I want you to learn the thing that you see in life, you have to, how to draw meaning from them. So, I remember my mother really struggled to collect 21 rupees which were required for me to get admission in the secondary school. On seventh in the 7th standard, I was in Marathi Municipal School. I stood first with some 87.5% mark. Those days, you didn't used to get 100% mark, by the way. You know, I stood 11th in SSC, right? My percentage was 81.43%. And the fellow who stood first, Agashe, was 83%. We didn't used to get 98 and 100 and 102%. At that time, 80 was considered as big. So my mother struggled to get 21 rupees in time. And we got it from another poor lady whose life saving was, she gave it to us. And by that time, all the admissions were closed to good schools. So I went to a poor school, but that poor school had rich teachers, like Principal Bhavish. And he believed in our actually seeing the world and learning, rather than just chalk and talk, you know, back to the students. You know. So he would take us out. How many of you know how to make a soap? How to make a soap? You must have been taught in science classes.
Liquid soap.
What are the ingredients that you take?
Oil and all.
Glycerol, an alkali, mixing with it, you don't know. Okay. Doesn't matter. So, so he would actually take us to the factory and show. Like a Hindustan Unilever factory. So
the soap is made. So he actually did a very interesting experiment, which is to find the focal length of a convex lens. You know how to find the focal length of a convex lens? You know the experiment? You go out into the sun, hold a convex lens, right? And then what happens? Bright spot on the paper, no? You have done it all, no? You must have done it. So he also did that experiment. And I remember he turned to me and said that like this, if you focus, you can burn anything in the world, you can achieve anything. That impressed me. And I said, I must become a scientist. The power of science. But also it told me that you must focus on what you are doing. You know, many times you are watching television, you are on the mobile, and you are studying. That will not. You must concentrate. You must actually focus. But later on I learned quite a lot. If you have a convex lens, the sun's rays are parallel. And what is the property of parallel lines? They never meet. And what does convex lens do?
They meet.
Isn't it? So what is the kind of leadership you must have? Convex lens leadership. So going back to your caste, so that you all become parallel. This is my caste, this is your caste. His class, language, this is my language, this is this language, they don't meet. Religion, Hindu, Muslim, Christian, Parsi. So what does the convex lens leadership do? It brings them all together. So what the nation needs is a convex lens leadership, correct? Which brings everybody together. And I learned quite a lot, by the way, from that simple lesson. So when I became the director of MCL, we had divisions in organic chemistry, physical chemistry, biochemistry. They're all divided. Each had their own. They say nothing to them. One MCL. So that all of them partnered with each other, co-create and so on. Then I became director general of CSL. 40 about me. You have heard about NCL?
Yes, sir.
So like NCL, there is NPL, National Physical. There is NAL, National Aeronautical Laboratory. Like that, there are 40 laboratories. 20,000 people, I was heading it. And all these 40 labs also wouldn't talk to each other. They were all parallel. They used to fight amongst them. I said, nothing to do. Convex lens leadership. Bring them together. Team CSR, one India. So what we require is a one India movement. Get the point. But the point that you raised is very important, and I'm very happy to see you are bothered by the fact that on the basis of caste, religion, language, the country is getting divided. And you must actually, each one of you must become a convex lens leader. Remember this terminology, convex lens. What does concave lens do? It's separate. So we have concave lens. Isn't it? That's why there's pride. So you must say, your tagline should be from concave to convex. Get my point? And each one of you should be able to do that. Okay? Wonderful answer again. Good. Yeah.
My dream is to make
Raghunath
Anant Mashelkar Sir work
for
ISRO, rather than NASA. I would like to work for DRDO because of terrorism, many of the people are feeling insecure. Hmm. And so I would like to stop the misuse of science and technology.
So, India of your dreams is one that is free of terrorism.
Yes, sir.
Why do you think terrorism takes place?
Due to misunderstandings and violence, fights between nations.
Hmm. And why does that happen? Why nations fight?
Because they think that their nation is superior.
Hmm.
So that they should conquer everything.
Hmm.
And this mentality should be stopped.
Absolutely. I totally agree with you. Now, how to stop it? Supposing you were the president of the world. There's nothing like president of the world. But let's say you're the president of the world and the whole world was listening to you. And you want them to cooperate with each other and work together for world peace, let us say. What would you do?
First of all, first I would like to spread the message of equality. No one is poor and no one is rich. All
very
are
good.
Equal.
Very good.
And no one is intelligent and or no one is dumb. Hmm. Everyone has equal intelligence and hmm. everyone has to use it. And we should have cooperation and unity among ourselves, rather hmm. than selfishness and others.
Excellent. So, in your school, for example, this lesson is very important. So, can you give me some instance on what do you learn within the school which teaches you this, basically, that we must all be equal, we must come together, peace, harmony, and what is good for the world. How do you learn that in your school?
Sir, our school provides various opportunities to work in a group rather than separate.
Wonderful. Wonderful.
And also, we are today in a group here to meet you. So, we must have unity among ourselves and we should not have competition that I am superior.
No wonder you are the head girl. Brilliant, absolutely brilliant. I think that is what is important. You know, the way the education system is changing. Come sit down. You know, in our time, we all were doing learning by rote. Means memorize everything, and then in exam they will ask you what you already know, okay, or what is stored here, and then you write that answer. They will ask you what is Newton's first law of motion, and you would have mugged it up, and then you write this is Newton's first law of motion. Get the point? So that is learning by rote, mugging. From there, one moves to learning by doing. Doing means what? Doing experiments. But how? Only what the teachers have told you. Step 1, step 2, step 3, step 4, step 5. Don't miss any step. That means don't go out of what teacher has instructed you. Right? That is learning by doing. Better than that is learning by creating. That means you create your own, you see, something new. And the best is learning by co-creating. Co-creating means working in a group and working together. So you have a wonderful school which is teaching you the right things. How you co-create. The only thing will be going into future. It is not man and man or man and woman or woman and woman. It's going to be man and machine. You have to learn to work with a machine, like robots and artificial intelligence and other things that are coming up. You know, the machines are taking over a lot of routine jobs, you know. So it will not be a human being who will be doing some manual work, but it will be a machine who will be doing the manual work. Okay? So you are replacing a man by a machine. So you should know how to interact with machine. So, from learning by rote, to learning by doing, to learning by creating, to learning by co-creating. Wonderful. So let us give her a big hand. Yes. Who else? Yeah. Second question? No. I'll work. Yeah. Fresh.
Good evening, sir. This is Vivek Chetty from Standard 9. So as we heard today, these days that women is insecure in our country. We hear lots of cases of girls of 8 years to women of 65 years. Also, small babies also being raped and those kind of things. I want a nation that will be free of these all things, and women must be regarded as the first citizen of India.
Wonderful. This itself deserves a clap. What is it? So supposing you are the Prime Minister of India. You are in total charge. What would you do to make that happen?
Sir, I will introduce some scientific technology for that.
Like what?
Some devices that can help women to protect themselves against men of course, greater than their ability to control.
Are you aware of any such science and technology which can protect them? Already?
No, sir.
No. I think, do you use Google? Do you go to the internet?
Sure. Yes, sir.
You will find number of those things, by the way. Already they are being developed, yes, as a matter of fact. But even before that, like I said, what are the fundamentals? This happens when a man tries to do something, isn't it? Why should you do that at all to start with? So unless that fundamental behavior is changed, you get my point.
Yes.
And there's one thing to do a crime and therefore there is a punishment. But why do the crime at all? I would like to see a nation like Japan, for example. You know what has happened in Japan? There is no work for the police. Why there is no work for the police? Because everybody is so well behaved. So what do the police do now? They do social welfare activities now. In Norway, the prisons are empty and they are being used as godowns now. You understand? That's the fundamental change. No need for a science or technology or a weapon or a protection and so on and so forth. The social behavior, that's why the ethics comes in. The sense of what is good and what is not good. That has to be taught and practiced, basically. Practice, very important. Because, let's say, in the school, you are told, Satyameva Jayate, right? Always speak truth and finally truth prevails and truth is the ultimate and so on. But at home, supposing, the father gets a phone call and he tells his daughter or son, tell him I'm not at home. What does that do? So, it is not just learning in school, lessons of ethics, practicing them. And then, you young people should have the courage to tell your father, sir, this, daddy, this is not right. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
Now this is happening, like for example, Swachh Bharat, you know, I'm the chairman of a committee which select those technologies, basically, you see. But beyond technology, what we are doing in that, we are training young children like you, who will participate, basically, in that actual movement. And if somebody is doing wrong, or doing something, they will go and tell them, basically, this is not right. So we have to build a different kind of society where the behavior changes. I remember going to China in 1991 because we had a bid on a particular project. It was the first time we were doing it. And we did not have money even to hire a translator. So I requested the Indian embassy to give us somebody who will be able to do translation, Chinese to English, English to Chinese. I still remember we were going in a car. And he came out and he was smoking in the car and he threw his cigarette butt like this. A little girl came from school, just like you, maybe of your age,